Dear sisters and brothers in Jesus Christ, Mr. Andrew and Mr. Joseph were neighbors and good friends. On the occasion of the Silver Jubilee of Andrew's marriage, Joseph and family presented him a very beautiful aquarium with the fish of different hues and colors. Joseph's son had a habit of teasing the daughter of Andrew. Andrew did not obviously like it and had brought it to the notice of both Joseph and his son. One day, Joseph's son posted a photo of the daughter of Andrew on Facebook with a very inappropriate comment. Andrew felt very angry. Next morning, he took the aquarium which Joseph's family had presented, brought it to Joseph's house and left it there on the table. Before Joseph could recover from the shock, Andrew walked out without saying a word. That was it. The friendship was broken. They were divided. Joseph was in a dilemma. What was he to do? Retaliate in anger? Hold on to his right to be angry at Andrew's rude behavior and let the relationship die? Teach Andrew a lesson? After much thought and prayer, Joseph took the aquarium back to Andrew the next evening. Andrew expected the worst, but Joseph just placed it on the table saying, "When it was first given to you, it was given in love. Now I return it with the same love." A teardrop rolled down Andrew's cheek and he embraced Joseph. Quarrels, divisions. We find this in every family, every parish, every community. The community at Corinth was no different, as we heard it from the second reading of today, taken from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. The Christian community at Corinth was divided. They were divided mainly on two grounds, on the ground of nationality and on the ground of their understanding of what it meant to follow Christ. Some of them claimed to belong to Paul, the apostle to the Gentiles. They were mostly converts who must have been Greeks and Romans. They felt themselves to be a separate group. Some of them claimed to belong to Peter. They were obviously Jews, the converts from Israel. They felt themselves to be a special group. Some of them claimed to belong to Apollos. They were people who tried to present Christianity in abstract philosophical terms rather than as a simple religion of love. Some of them claimed to belong to Christ. They were self-righteous people who held on rigidly to laws and traditions and claimed that they were the only true Christians. The causes of divisions among us can be many. Words said in anger, a misunderstanding, the experience of being cheated, instances of infidelity, linguistic allegiance, socio-cultural differences. St. Paul exhorted the Christians of Corinth to mend the divisions among them and to live in unity, saying, "I appeal to you that all of you be in agreement and that there be no divisions among you." 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 10. We have to be united because we are all members of the body of Christ and Christ is one. Just as St. Paul tried to be an agent of unity among the Christians of Corinth, we have to be bridge builders in our homes, workplaces, and communities. What can we do to overcome the divisions among us? I would like to indicate five things. First, become aware and be convinced that unity is what Jesus wants. In fact, on the day of the Last Supper, looking at his disciples, he prayed that they may all be one. The Gospel of St. John, chapter 17, verse 20. Division is the work of the devil. The Greek word for devil is diabolos, which among other things means one who separates. In his letter to the Galatians, chapter 5, verse 20, St. Paul lists quarrels, enmities, dissensions and factions among the works of the flesh as opposed to the works of the Spirit. In his Angelus message of 25th January 2015, Pope Francis said, "The devil, as we know, is the father of division. He is one that always divides, always makes war, and does so much evil." Second, dialogue. When the early Christian community faced a serious crisis due to differences of opinion with regard to what should be demanded of those who get converted and become Christians, the apostles called the whole community together for an honest and open dialogue. Research shows that even in situations where terrorists take hostages, better results are achieved by dialoguing with the terrorists than by attacking them. Let us, with openness and a willingness to listen, talk about our grievances so that we may be able to find acceptable solutions. Third, be ready to make a sacrifice, to give up a right. If each one holds on to his or her position or right, it will be difficult to arrive at resolutions of a conflict. We have to show willingness to give up our right for the sake of peace and unity, which we value as a greater good. In Genesis chapter 13, when Abraham felt that there was the possibility of a fight between him and Lot, his nephew, over the land needed to support their sheep and cattle, Abraham gave up his right to have the first pick of the land and told Lot, "Let there be no strife between you and me. If you take the left hand, then I will go to the right. Or if you take the right hand, then I will go to the left." Are we willing to make a sacrifice, to give up a right? Fourth, accept our mistake and ask pardon. Offer forgiveness if the other has made a mistake. Like the prodigal son, we must turn to those whom we have offended and humbly say, "I have sinned against heaven and against you." As Lee Strobel says, few things accelerate the peace process as much as humbly admitting our own wrongdoing and asking forgiveness. Apologizing is indicative of a noble heart. Forgive others as often as they have offended us. The invitation of the Lord is to forgive 70 times 7, that is, always. Offering forgiveness is not a sign of weakness. Mahatma Gandhi says, "The weak can never forgive. Forgiveness is the attribute of the strong." Fifth, pray. God is love. He is the one who can heal divisions and bring about unity. Pray that the God of peace may act in us and act in every situation of division so that unity may be restored and we may become bridge builders. Today, as we celebrate the Republic Day, let us ask God that our country may awake into that haven of freedom where the world has not been broken up into fragments by narrow domestic walls. We shall conclude praying one of the verses of the Christmas carol, "O Come, O Come, Emmanuel." O come, O King of Nations, bind in one the hearts of all humankind. Bid all our sad divisions cease, and be yourself our King of Peace. Amen.